Hello, my quilting friends. Leah Day here with a new video for the machine quilting party. We're getting started with our beautiful rainbow log cabin quilt. And the very first step is the step that we take with every quilt project. And that is to prepare our fabric, get it squared up, and begin cutting the pieces accurately. So let's get started learning how to do this together. So the first step is to gather your fabrics, and these are the fabrics I've chosen to create my rainbow log cabin quilt. You're gonna need a little bit of black for the corners, but the rest of it is just simply a beautiful rainbow. And I have chosen Island Batik fabrics and this very subtle kind of blender. So we've got some dots and we've got some, this is almost like a dandelion. We've got some donuts. I love that. So cheerful. This is almost like an oil slick. Some more dots. And this is almost like a flower, a spirally flower design. So the first step to creating your quilt is to prep up these fabrics. So I've taken and washed all of them. Because they're batiks, you really do need to be careful about washing them and make sure to wash until they have bled out completely, basically. They will bleed some. So what I did was I decided to wash like the orange and red together. And as they were washing, I threw in a square, like a scrap of white fabric, something about 10 inches square, threw that in the wash along with a die grabber, and then washed it and then checked that scrap of fabric. That scrap of fabric comes out even slightly discolored, wash it again. So keep washing until the fabrics come out so that they're not bleeding dye on anything else. So I could group together the red and the orange, and I believe I also grouped together the green and the blue, and then I grouped together the purple and the black. So it's gonna be a little bit of process of washing, but it's totally worth it because you don't want any of these colors migrating. They'll end up discoloring the yellow, and that's such a bright, cheerful yellow. You really want it to come out just exactly that way in the finished quilt. So take your time washing your fabrics, and the next step is to learn how to press it, starch it, and square it for cutting. So I'm getting started prepping up my red fabric by spraying it with starch. So I've already washed it, made sure that the fabric was color safe and not bleeding any dye. I don't want anything to come across pink. Pink is not a color in this rainbow quilt. So I'm spraying this with starch, and I like Niagara brand spray starch. I like it simply because it comes with a spray nozzle. It's easier to tell how much you've got left. You can shake the bottle and feel it. And it also is a little bit better for the environment than an aerosol. I also like this because it has minimal scent and it is starch. I don't use sizing, I don't use best press, anything like that. I use starch. Now, I know there's a whole debate about starch and fabric and bugs, but here's the thing about that. Cotton fabric is already yummy to a bug. You know, adding starch doesn't make it any more yummy to a bug. And here's the other thing. We've been using starch for thousands of years to stiffen fabric. And also, it will wash out completely whenever you get your quilt wet. So for all of those reasons, I think it's perfectly fine to use starch on your fabric. And it's actually a really important part of the process. So that way the fabric will be stiff and stable and easy to cut. Now you can see, what am I doing? I am giving my quilt, my fabric, a little massage. I'm encouraging that liquid to bond with the fabric. And the reason I want that to happen is because I want the starch to really sink into and bond with the fibers. I have a nice hot iron, but I don't want to hit the starch really wet and liquidy and then have the fabric, you know, the starch just flake off onto the back of my iron. I would rather it bond with the fabric firmly. Now, you might have situations where, you know, you've sprayed, but not everything has really gotten completely covered. This is a tip that I picked up from Dad. This is something that Dad does. He folds up the fabric, so he'll starch everything at once. And this is a good processing tip when you're processing all the fabric for your quilt in one day. Just take it, fold it up, and kind of put it in a bin or a plastic box, or even just a plastic grocery bag, and leave it to set for maybe the length of time that it takes you to starch all of your fabric. So as you're starching the red, go on ahead and work through the orange through to the purple. And then by the time you get all the way through, then you can open up that red and it will have, all the starch will have soaked into the fabric really firmly and have kind of dispersed and evened itself out. So that's a suggestion for, you know, as you're batching things out, that will certainly save you some time and it will result in a much more even amount of starch throughout. Now, I'm kind of in a hurry and I'm shooting this in a video, so I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to go ahead and spray those areas that I missed. And then something that's really important I kind of missed because I was scrunching my fabric so much, and that is to spray one side of the fabric and then flip it over and press from the opposite side. And the reason we do that, again, is to prevent the starch from flaking off whenever you hit it with your iron. You want the starch to be bonding with the fabric, not anything else. So now I'm smoothing this out so it's nice and flat on my pressing board. And having a firm pressing board is essential. This is one of, I think, the most important tools you can have in your sewing space. So if you haven't built one for yourself yet, definitely watch my tutorial on building a firm pressing board. It doesn't take a lot of time, it's not expensive, and it's not hard to do. And it results in such a better quilting experience. Okay, so this is smoothed out nice and flat, and now I'm gonna hit it with my iron. Now, technically, when we are preparing fabric for a quilt, we are pressing, which means set your iron down and let go of it or hold on to it, but don't wiggle it around. The thing is, I'm a wiggler. I learned how to iron when I was a little girl. I didn't learn how to press. So I get bored really easily and I start wiggling the iron around. So far, that hasn't proved to be too detrimental to my quilting. I've never found that distorted the fabric too badly, but it's something that, you know, maybe do as I say, not as I do. You will notice some steam coming up. That is happening as the iron, which is on the highest setting, it's super, super hot. The iron is hitting that starch and it's causing some steam as it dries the starch really nicely on the fabric. I am not using steam. I have no water in this iron. I'm not using any steam in the iron at all. I don't like to have water in my irons. I find that when I put water in my irons, it usually causes them to break very quickly. They start to leak, they start to have heating issues. So I very rarely put steam in my iron. And I would say there's only really about three techniques in all of quilting that I actually use steam. And they are for some pretty weird stuff like fabric manipulation and things like that. So I don't ever pretty much have water in my iron, and I pretty much don't ever use steam. I like a hot, dry iron. I want this to dry out and stiffen. And you can see just how nice and stiff that is. You can hear it. It sounds stiff. I love that. So that's what you're aiming for here. You want it to be super stiff and stable. And let's talk about that. Why do we want it stiff and stable? Well, fabric naturally, when you know, comes out of the washer, even when you come home from the store, it has a natural amount of stretch. The reason why we use quilting cotton, and this particular woven quilting cotton, is because it has minimal stretch. It has minimal movement. So we can cut our pieces and piece them accurately. But when you bring it straight home from the store, it will still have some stretch. It will still have some movement. And that's just the natural way fabric is. You know, it's always going to have a little bit of give, a little bit of shift, a little bit of stretch. When we apply starch, we take that away. And so that stiffens it, that locks the fibers together so they're stiff and stable. We want the fabric to be almost as stiff and stable as paper. And that's going to make it so much easier to cut our pieces accurately. So imagine trying to cut something that's just loosey-goosey, shifting all over the place. You know, as you're cutting across that, the fabric's moving against your blade. Then look at how stiff and stable this is. It's going to set flat on my cutting mat. As I cut across it with my rotary ruler, you know, pressing against it, it's going to stay that shape. I'm going to be able to cut out exact shapes from this fabric because it's so stiff and stable. You might never have tried this before, but I really want to encourage you to give this a try this time and see if it works for you. This is the thing about quilting, is there's so many different techniques and there's so many different ways to make a quilt. And sometimes we kind of get stuck in our methods and, you know, stop trying new things. And it's really important to branch out, try new things, see what works, you know, chuck what doesn't work for you. I completely understand that, but it's important to keep trying new things and see if that improves your skill. This is one of those things that a lot of quilters really don't like, you know, don't really like starching and pressing fabric. It takes a little extra time, but I honestly believe that this is really the key to producing quilts that are accurately pieced, that come out with the seams matching and looking great. So I'm going to continue starching and pressing all of this fabric. I've already starched it, so I'm just going to press it dry. So it's dry, stiff, and stable. And the next step will be squaring it up. We're going to give it a little dance, a little fabric dance, in order to square up the edges so it's ready for cutting. So the next step is the fabric dance. And what this does is it squares the fabric so that the fibers within the fabric that wove it together, the weft and the weave, are running straight and perpendicular to the edges. Now that might sound really technical, but it's really just a wiggle back and forth in order to do this. And what this does is it ensures that if you cut, let's say, a really long strip from selvage to selvage, which is what we need to do, that those strips will come out completely straight and not have any kind of V's or dips in it. That's a sign that the fabric was off square. So if you've been noticing some issues, maybe your strips are not as straight as you'd like them to be, this tip will really help. So what you're gonna do is hold your fabric in your fingers, and you can see how I'm gripping it, just like that. And then that's holding it so that way I can wiggle the start of the fabric against the other side. So I can basically wiggle the two ends back and forth. So I'm gonna lift this up here, and I'm gonna wiggle it so that way it's really far off. And you can see that diagonal ripple that happens across. Okay, so now I'll go the other way, and I'm just shifting the fabric, the two ends of the fabric, against one another. So now we've kind of gone in the opposite direction. Now it's off the opposite way. So what you do when you're doing this fabric dance is you're basically just wiggling it back and forth until it seems straight, until it's even, until you don't get like a really deep ripple running diagonally from your fingertips, and that the bottom edge, especially where you have the fold, is nice and straight. So this looks good to me right here. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna set it on my table, and I'm going to just hand press that in place. Now I'm gonna grab the fabric again. This time, I'm grabbing the fold and those two sets of selvages together. So you can see how I'm holding that, because this is a pretty big piece of fabric. This is a full yard of fabric, and being able to square a full yard is really good. Now, of course, we have bigger cuts of fabric within this quilt pattern. With those bigger cuts, go on ahead and cut them down into manageable sizes. So go on ahead and rip it to a length that feels comfortable for you. And ripping is better than cutting when you're working with big pieces of fabric like this, because that's going to rip with the grain line of the fabric. So as you can see, I've ripped my edges, and that makes it much, much easier to work with. Okay, so now I'm gonna do that fabric dance again, this time to square up the second fold. So here you can see that's way far off that way. Now I'll go back and wiggle it so it's way far off the other way. You can see that ripple. That's what you don't want. So it's really good to know what you don't want and then what you do want. And notice also, I did not grab my iron and press this. I just hand pressed that first fold. So there we go. That fabric looks nice and square and straight. I set this down on my cutting mat. We're gonna start cutting some strips together. So I've set my fabric up here on the mat, and this is the way I always start. I have the two selvages up at the top, and then this is the first fold that we created during that little dance. Okay, so that all smooths up, and I keep that at the top of my cutting mat. And then down here at the bottom, I have the second fold. So there's two layers of fabric here folded up. So now I'm gonna take my cutting ruler, and here's something that's really important. Whatever ruler you decide to use, make sure you use it throughout the entire process. So this is the ruler that I'm gonna cut out all of the shapes for the entire quilt. And the reason being, you know, how these lines are marked and how thin they are, you're gonna get used to that whenever you're cutting your strips. When you start cutting out those strips and cutting the pieces, you wanna maintain that. Different rulers have different thicknesses of lines, and that can affect your cutting too. So the first step is to square up these edges. You can see this fabric was ripped, but even still, it's a little off over here. And I don't want to include this fuzzy edge in my block. So I want to cut that off. So the first thing I'm going to do is line up with this bottom fold. I trust this bottom fold on my fabric. That's the only thing I'm going to trust here. I'm not going to line up that fold on a line on the mat though, because the mat, because we're cutting into it all the time, that can get off. So I am trusting the lines on my ruler and that fold line on the fabric. And I talk about that a lot, what you can trust at any point in time. Now I'm left-handed, so I'm gonna cut with my left hand right across. And I do like 60 millimeter blades. They're really nice, they're big, and if you think about it, the bigger the blade, the less it's turning, so the sharper it stays. And I use titanium Fiskars blades, and they stay sharp a really long time. We do a lot of cutting, and those we've noticed really stay sharp the longest. So now that I've trimmed up one side, I'm gonna flip this over. I wanna keep cutting with my dominant hand. So I need to flip the fabric so I can keep doing that. Yes, you can learn how to switch hands, and I've done that for years. However, I cut myself a few years ago really badly while I was making a video, and I learned I really should be setting a better example and also showing safer cutting techniques. So I learned to always be cutting with my dominant hand. Okay, so now we're going to line up two things on our ruler. We're going to be cutting 2.5 inch strips. So I'm lining up the 2.5 inch mark, and I want to include the line. Now I know that sounds a little picky, but basically the line on the ruler, the little black line in this case, is meant to be included in that cut. So make sure to shift your ruler over. It might only be a thread thickness, that thickness of that line, but that's enough to throw your pieces off. So make sure to include the line in the cut. I'm also lining up that bottom fold line with that thin line on my ruler. It can be any line, but just that line is lined up with that fold. So I know that when I cut, it's going to be straight and perpendicular. So again, press firmly, cut right across. Now let's check our strip. I was talking about just a bit ago about how your strip can end up slightly wonky and you can end up with like a V. So that will look like the fabric kind of dips inward. You can also end up looking like that, like a peak. So here, let's check our fabric. That looks great. We'll open it all the way up. If you're gonna have an issue, the worst one is gonna be that middle fold, and that looks great. Nice straight strip. That's how you want to cut all the strips for your quilt, and then cut those strips down into pieces. Now, when it comes to cutting into pieces, if you leave your strip layered together nicely, then of course you can keep those layers in nice alignment. Because I open this all the way up, I'm going to cut single pieces. And definitely follow your cutting chart and follow this tip. Always cut your biggest pieces first. And the reason we want to do that is because you're going to end up with extra leftovers at the end. If you cut your biggest pieces first, then you can use the rest of the strip for the smaller pieces. So the first thing we're going to do is trim up the strip and square it. So I'm going to flip it over again, always cutting with my dominant hand. I'm going to line up the ruler here. And basically all I'm doing here is lining up thin lines on the ruler with that the edges of the strip. We know the edges of the strip are what we can trust, so I'm just wanting to make sure that that's nice and straight all the way through. If I was to take my ruler and go over here, well, we don't have very much to go off of, and I could end up wonky and not even realize it. So you want to have as much of the ruler on top of the fabric as you can anytime that you're cutting. So here we have that full 12 inches of ruler on top of that fabric. So we know that's nice and straight. So now that edge is cut straight too. And now let's cut a few pieces from this together. Like I said, if I had left it layered together, I would probably cut two pieces at once. But because I shifted it, we're going to cut only one piece at a time. So here we go. I'm lining up. I know my biggest piece. So I'm lining up a thin line on my ruler, so I cut it to the right length. I'm lining up thin lines on my ruler here, So that way I know the strip is straight across. Press firmly and cut that piece. So cut your biggest pieces that you need for the quilt first, and then with the leftovers from the strip, you'll be able to cut your smaller pieces out. And that's the best way to cut this quilt very efficiently. So that's it for this video. I hope you learned a lot and you're excited about getting your fabrics prepped up and cut for our rainbow log cabin quilt. Now, if you're wondering where the quilt pattern is, you can find it in this book, Explore Walking Foot Quilting with Leah Day. Together, we're going to create this beautiful log cabin quilt and quilt it together with Walking Foot style quilting. So if you're looking for the pattern and you'd like to follow along, find it in this new book. You can find it at leahday.com/walkingfoot. If you enjoyed this video, please like it, share it with your friends, and subscribe to my channel on YouTube so you don't miss the next video coming out soon. Until next time, let's go quilt!